it's really about, I use the word female gaze as language just to start that conversation, since the active male gaze has dominated all forms of representation in history, from fashion, film, art, sculpture. A lot of the work that we study is look at the subject with the active male gaze and take that in, whether it be even a male figure or a genderless object like a plate. It's always this, I'm the active viewer on this passive subject, look at it. And so I use the words female gaze to kind of counter that way of taking in a work and becoming open to the experience of this thing. Like, what is, how does this make you feel? What are the things that you can't see but are felt? And that's the human experience. So when we talk about, even in architecture, yes, it's a building, it's a physical object in space, and a lot of people design that way. They're like, I want to make the tallest building. But with my architecture background, I was really interested in the quality of space. Like, when you walk in, is there an element of surprise when you walk through this way and the light hits you this way? Or, you know, when you walk into a room, you get goosebumps. Why is that? You can't really see that. So I say that's the female gaze, the realm of experience, the realm of not being the active viewer with the gaze on this passive thing. So when you walk through here, it's, you know, what stories are being told here? What does that evoke in you? It kind of opens it up in a more experiential way, in sort of this sort of consume me as a work of art or an object. So that's what I call the female gaze. Frankenthaler, I actually just recently discovered her because she used unprimed canvas, which back in the day was unheard of. You know, you're breaking the rules, we need to have the gesso, the layers of protection, and all these things. So she kind of broke the rules and started just pouring all over the floor. So I was like, I need to invoke her spirit to tackle this large scale work on unprimed canvas. She actually started working with acrylic because she liked the mark making of acrylic over oil, which is what I'm more comfortable with. So she's kind of like a rule breaker. Yeah. And then I just decided to use mops to make this. And whatever texture shows up on top, it's a lot of play and experimentation and a lot of like embracing uncertainty, which is what a lot of last year was, when you don't have control over what's next, but you can just focus on, you know, what's the very next step that I can take and work with that. Otherwise it becomes overwhelming, and I did have those moments of like, what am I doing? And then talking about Maya Lin and the Vietnam Memorial, she is the reason why I even was inspired to pursue architecture, because with that memorial, she held space for the collective grief of a very unpopular war. And you have to actually come close to the marble wall to see which person died at what time, so your last name doesn't get lost in a sea of other last names. So here it's like, I wanted to have different stories being told, and you have to walk up close to see those things at the same time. And then there's a play with this being engulfed by darkness and then this soft release as you walk out. So I'm really excited about this piece because it does have a little blend of architecture and art in terms of experiencing space and experiencing art on such a big scale. It's kind of a really rich blend of those structures or forms of visual art, I guess. And it's funny though, because I also think of like architecture, like this room, it's a container for human experience. So also when I paint, the painting becomes a portal for human experience. And it's crazy because when I saw this space, I was like, this is a literal portal. Like, if you looked up the definition of a portal, it's even outlined with these LED lights. So it's cool to actually have a portal literally and figuratively. Well, with unprimed canvas, it tends to bleed. So I did use acrylic in a way that is more fluid. I added more water to it and I used a very simple mop. I bought different brooms, but this particular mop was just a very simple sponge. So I really liked the mark making element of it. When I release, it kind of floods. And then I also like the allusion to the water element. Sometimes I joke and I say I'm emotionally flooding. So I think the mop is also very apt in expressing that in a like elemental way too. Like the application of this is very drippy, very like soaked. And then working with oil stick, I went back to just plain soft graphite pencil, like a 3B pencil. And Prismacolors are good because the oil, it's a little blend of wax and oil, so it gets the fine line weight that I needed to have the script show. Yeah. And then of course the space makes it too. Just the scale of it and being able to walk in between it, that played a huge part in the concept of being enveloped by this wave, this dark wave, and then having this release and mirroring that on both ends. Mm. And the people's stories, that brings it more to life. And then when people actually come and connect with it, that becomes part of the piece. A lot of them were actually submitted by the Houston Asian American Archives here. So yourself and interns helped go parse through stories of human strife, human resilience, grief, joy, every feeling in between, and an open call for submissions. I got two poetry entries that are very moving. And that really inspired me in how to space the words. Because I find poetry to be, poetry just transcends human language. So that's like my favorite thing to work with in terms of words. And a lot of them actually have their own stories recorded here too, as part of the archives. And I thank everyone for collecting those and helping me with that. And some of them are actually, one of them is from my father who passed away, and he would joke a lot and he would say things like, instead of saying, we'll cross the bridge when we get there, like a very popular saying, he will say, we'll cross the bridge together. And so that really stuck with me because it kind of made more sense with me in terms of feeling like I'm overwhelmed and alone in this one particular feeling or situation in life. And so I found those words to actually be more comforting than we'll cross the bridge when we get there. And so I included that as well. It's like a homage to my ancestors in a way. Some people whose voices aren't heard, people whose voices aren't published, I wanted to include those, as well as some voices of our time, like our Madam Vice President this year. She's got one on that side. The bridge means, well, to connect. And at the same time, it is a metaphor for how all Asian Americans wound up here, even though I wasn't born here. I am still connected to my home country of the Philippines because my parents came. And this is a reference to how we got here and the flow of migration and some of the displacement that comes along with that, but then it's also part of our story, so that does connect us at the same time. So I included another quote saying, sometimes the ocean is a bridge. And I find it very fitting because this space is sort of like a bridge. It's a narrow connector between this space and the other. So maybe when people walk through it, they feel like they're crossing a threshold as well. That's it.
I'm really thankful for Rachel and for Anne for putting this exhibit together, because we all need a place to grieve and to think about the sadness and the hardships that have been going on. Rachel has quoted a friend of hers who died in 2013 and has a good quote from her, which is one of those things about living life fully and while you can. And I wish more people could come be here. And the progression of this space going through, it's like the ups and downs that the other writer talks about, the ups and the downs. And it also embraces, you know, it comes around. Rachel's very good at giving visualization to what everyone's experiencing. Even if we don't know it all the time, it's there. It's very powerful. And the merging, the weaving of the words with the canvas and the paint, the ink, it's ink, isn't it?
Yeah, it's acrylic, yeah.
Is really strong, it's powerful. So, to see the textures of where she was wiping and rubbing and writing. Thank you, Rachel. Thank you, Anne.